Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ransomware Protection Playbook by Roger A. Grimes. Narrated by Danny Campbell. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. I've been doing computer security since 1987, for more than 34 years now. I remember the first ransomware program I or anyone else alive at the time saw. It arrived in December 1989 on a 5 1/4-inch floppy disk and quickly became known as the AIDS PC Cyborg Trojan. Wes didn't call it ransomware then. You don't make up entirely new classification names until you get more than one of something, and at the time it was the first and only. It remained that way for years. Little did we know that it would be the beginning of a gigantic digital crime industry and a huge blight of digital evil across the world in the decades ahead. It was fairly simple as compared to today's ransomware programs, but it still had enough code to thoroughly obfuscate data, and its creator had enough moxie to ask for $189 ransom in order to restore the data. The story of the first ransomware program and its creator still seems too strange and unlikely even today. If someone tried to duplicate the truth in a Hollywood hacker movie, you wouldn't believe it. Today's ransomware creators and gangs are far more believable. Dr. Joseph L. Popp, Jr., the creator of the first ransomware program, was a Harvard-educated evolutionary biologist turned anthropologist. He had become interested in AIDS research and was actively involved in the AIDS research community at the time of his arrest. How he got interested in AIDS research isn't documented, but perhaps it was his 15 years in Africa documenting hamadryas baboons. Dr. Popp had co-authored a book on the Kenya Maasai Mari Nature Reserve in 1978, amazon.com/mara-field-guide-maasai-reserve/dp/b000715z0c, and published a scientific paper on his baboon studies in April 1983. link.springer.com/article/10.1007/BF0238102. AIDS is thought to have originated from non-human primates in Africa, and those theories were starting to be explored more around the same time frame as people searched for patient zero. Dr. Popp was in the right place at the right time. His study of one could have led to the other. Back in the late 1980s, AIDS research and understanding was fairly new and very rudimentary. There was still a widespread fear of the relatively new disease and how it was transmitted. Unlike with today's treatments and antivirals, early on getting HIV/AIDS was a death sentence. At the time, many people were afraid of kissing or even hugging people who might have AIDS or were in high-risk groups. There was great interest for the latest information and learnings inside and out of the medical community. No one besides Dr. Popp knows why he decided to write the world's first ransomware program. Some have speculated he was disgruntled at not getting a much-desired job in the AIDS research industry and wanted to strike back. But it can just as easily be stated that he just wanted to make sure he got paid for his work. Still, there are definite signs of hiding and malevolent intent from a man who knew his creation would not be taken well. It's hard to say you didn't know something was illegal when you try to hide your involvement. Dr. Popp purchased a mailing list of attendees from a recently held October 1988 AIDS conference in Stockholm, put on by the World Health Organization, and purportedly also used the subscriber lists of a UK computer magazine called PC Business World and other business magazines. Dr. Popp created the Trojan Horse program using the Quick Basic 3.0 programming language. It must have taken him months of code writing and testing. When he was finished, he copied it onto more than 20,000 disks, applied labels, printed accompanying usage instructions, applied postage manually, and then mailed them to unsuspecting recipients in the United States, United Kingdom, Africa, Australia, and other countries. Dr. Pop must have had help doing all of this, because creating 20,000 software packages and manually applying postage would likely have taken weeks and weeks of work by one person. But no other person's involvement was ever declared in court documents or volunteered by Dr. Pop. The Trojan floppy disk was labeled AIDS Information Introductory Diskette. The floppy disk instructions introduce the disk as purporting to be a program with information about AIDS. After viewing, the user would be asked a series of personal behavior questions. The answer to those questions would be used to give the user a report on their personal risk of getting AIDS, along with recommendations on how to avoid getting it. The instructions included the warning, "If you use this diskette, you will have to pay the mandatory software licensing fees." This latter warning would later be used by Dr. Pop in his defense as to why his program should not be considered illegal extortion. You can see the instructions and ominous warning in Figure 1.2. Further, when the Trojan program was first run, it printed a license and invoice to the screen and to the printer if the PC was connected to a local printer. The license told users they must pay the software license and even included another ominous warning that you are unlikely to see on any legitimate software program. If you install this on a microcomputer, then under terms of this license, you agree to pay PC Cyborg Corporation in full for the cost of leasing these programs. In the case of your breach of this license agreement, PC Cyborg reserves the right to take legal action necessary to recover any outstanding debts payable to PC Cyborg Corporation and to use program mechanisms to ensure termination of your use. These program mechanisms will adversely affect other program applications. You are hereby advised of the most serious consequences of your failure to abide by the terms of this license agreement. Your conscience may haunt you for the rest of your life, and your PC will stop functioning normally. You are strictly prohibited from sharing this product with others. Just like today, most people didn't read software license agreements. Normally, it's not a problem, but in this case, not reading the license agreement with its unusual dire warning would take on special importance. In the late 1980s, a large percentage of users also didn't pay for any commercial software they were not forced to pay for. Software was routinely illegally copied and traded. It was incredibly common for people to copy disks for their friends or even sell, even if they hadn't paid the original developer. Local computer clubs held monthly disk swaps. If you didn't have to pay for software, you didn't. In response, some developers created copy protection routines that prevented easy standard disk copying. The author has seen other malicious programs and sites include similar fair warnings in their licensing information. It never hurts to read your end-user license agreements instead of simply trying your best to ignore and quickly get by them. Dr. Pop either didn't know how to do legitimate copy protection, or he counted singularly on his peculiar ransom enforcement for people who ignored his licensing instructions. Maybe he got the idea from an earlier malware program. In 1986, the first IBM PC-compatible computer virus, Pakistani Brain, wiki/brain_open_computer_virus, was created as a copy prevention mechanism. Its Pakistani creators were tired of people illegally copying without paying for disks they had themselves often illegally copied. You can't make this stuff up. It caused boot problems and indirectly might have caused some people to pay money to the inventors to resolve. The malware, however, did not encrypt anything nor directly ask for a ransom. There is a chance that Dr. Pop saw his ransomware program as simply a way to legally enforce his copyright and software license. There were warnings in at least two places clearly visible to users who used his software. In comparison, today's ransomware programs never give any warning. So perhaps in only that way, Dr. Pop's creation was a slight bit more ethical than today's ransomware programs. But being a slight bit more ethical criminal among more unethical criminals is not a particularly high standard that anyone should want to be measured against. Either way, the first time Dr. Pop's program was run by a user, it would install itself on the local hard drive, C, and modify the autoexec.bat file to use as a boot counter. After the involved PC was booted 90 or so times, the program would encrypt / obfuscate the user's files and folders. It would then display the message shown in Figure 1.3. No one knows why Dr. Pop put his trigger counter at 90. Perhaps he estimated that most people booted their PCs about once a day during the work week, and 90 work days was more than enough time for someone to send payment for their program and for him to return a block-the-lock executable disk. Dr. Pop had created a company with the name of PC Cyborg, which would lead to the naming of the virus. The name was shown in the original license and in the after-the-fact ransomware warning, along with asking for $189 for an annual license or $389 for a lifetime license to be sent to a Panama post office box. It was this information that led to his quick identification and arrest. Today's ransomware purveyors use hard-to-identify true ownership cryptocurrencies to avoid the same easy identification and detection by authorities. Dr. Pop had clearly tried to hide his identity and original involvement with his creation. As is still true today, it is common for unethical people trying to hide their identity and financial gains to use offshore corporations and accounts. At that time, Panama was popularly used as a financial and tax avoidance safe haven, much as the Cayman Islands and other offshore islands are used today. When the Trojan's program payload ran, before the ransom instructions were shown, it did some rudimentary symmetric encryption to the files and folders. It would move all the existing files and subdirectories into a new set of subdirectories under the root directory, rename them, and enable DOS, hidden attribute features on each file and folder, which made them seem to disappear. All the files and folders would also be renamed using high-order extended ASCII control characters, which made everything appear as being invisible. Even if the DOS hidden attribute was discovered and turned off, the file and folder names looked corrupted. If the impacted user tried to do some common exploratory commands to see what happened, the malicious code brought back a fake DOS screen with fake results to confuse the user. The main set of malicious subdirectories were created using extended ASCII character 255, which is a control code that looks like a space, even though it is not. But like a space, it would not display on the screen or when printed. For all intents and purposes, all the files and folders appeared to most users to have disappeared, or at least badly corrupted. But importantly, none of the files were actually encrypted, unlike today's ransomware programs. The names of the files and folders were just renamed and moved. The ransomware program created a conversion table that could be used to reverse the moving and renaming. If you found the table and understood what the Trojan program did, you could convert everything back to the original file and folder names and locations. Several individuals figured this out and wrote fix-it programs, including early computer virus expert Jim Bates. Bates created a free 40-page analysis report of the Trojan that he would send to anyone who requested it, and he published a shorter but still great analysis in the premier antivirus journal, Virus Bulletin, virusbulletin.com/uploads/magazine/1990/19901.pdf in January 1990. Bates revealed the many dubious routines of the program, including the multiple steps it took to fake what the user saw when investigating. It was a great example of the antivirus and online community coming together to defeat a common foe without thinking about profit. The PC Cyborg ransomware encryption routine used what cryptographers called simple character substitution for the encryption component. This is the absolute simplest type of encryption possible, and because of that, it's probably more accurate to call Dr. Pop's encryption routine obfuscation instead. It certainly wasn't anything close to as secure as how most digital encryption had been accomplished on computers for at least a decade before Dr. Pop's program, and much less sophisticated compared to encryption in today's ransomware variants. But the point is mostly semantic. To most victims, their data was gone, and their computers were unusable. Along with his detailed analysis, Bates created a free Trojan removal program called AIDS Out and a free AIDS Clear program that would restore any renamed and moved files to their original locations and names. The late John McAfee of McAfee Antivirus fame gained some early national media attention in the United States by talking about the ransomware program and by saying he went around rescuing people's locked-up PCs. It was the publicity surrounding John McAfee's computer virus recoveries during that time that led this author to disassembling DOS computer viruses for John McAfee later that year, and largely led to the author's lifetime career in cybersecurity. After the antivirus industry and law enforcement determined that Dr. Pop was involved, he was arrested on a warrant while at Amsterdam's Schiphol Airport and eventually imprisoned in London. During the arrest, it was immediately noted that he was having some mental health issues. Even before the arrest, he had apparently scribbled strange messages on another passenger's luggage, indicating that he, Dr. Pop, was in the luggage. He did many other unusual antics during this period of time, including wearing a condom on his nose and wearing curlers in his beard to ward off radiation. To this day, no one knows if he was really having mental health issues or just faking being insane to avoid being found guilty. Either way, he was originally arrested or detained in the Netherlands and sent back to his parents in Ohio in the United States at some point. He was then rearrested on many crimes, including blackmail, and extradited back to the United Kingdom for trial. Where the various arrests happened are swapped in some news stories, but it appears he was arrested or detained in two or three different countries at some point and faced some sort of adjudication in at least two of those countries. His final release came from a UK court. Dr. Pop's original defense was to claim that everything he did was legal because he warned users, and they were the ones not paying for what they were legally obligated to pay. Some lawyers thought he may have a valid legal point, even though it was unusual and unethical. Part of Dr. Pop's original defense fell apart because his program would also state that if users took his ransom program to another computer and allowed it to lock up that computer, that the program would then unlock the original computer so it could be used. This part of the program did not work, either intentionally or unintentionally, and both the original and additional PC would not be operational. It's unclear if Dr. Pop ever got paid or sent a single unlock disk, or if that unlock disk worked. I don't know of anyone who paid the ransom, and none of the victims in the dozens of old news stories claim to have paid the ransom or received an unlock disk from Dr. Pop. I think Dr. Pop was quickly on the run to avoid being arrested when his program started to make the news worldwide. It is doubtful that he had time to pick up his payments in Panama and send out unlock disks, and it is certainly true that he did not do this at scale. Every news story surrounding the PC Cyborg Trojan starred victims whose PCs were locked up. Dr. Pop claimed in court proceedings and to investigators that he planned to donate all the ransom money to AIDS research. That claim would be unlikely to persuade any court and would not result in the dismissal of any pending charges. Although it must be noted that Dr. Pop really did belong to several AIDS research groups that were raising money for research, and he was involved in several AIDS educational conferences and programs. In any case, one or more judges ruled that he was unfit to stand trial, and by November 1991, he was released back to his parents a free man by UK Judge Jeffrey Rivlin. He faded back into relative obscurity and turned his interest back toward human anthropology. His infamous actions, which had both directly attacked and unfairly maligned AIDS researchers around the world, precluded his continued involvement in that field. A decade later, in September 2001, he released a fairly controversial book called Popular Evolution Life Lessons, amazon.com/popular-evolution-life-lessons-joseph-pop/dp/0970125577, which contained many unconventional recommendations, including an aggressive focus on procreation, even by young females who had just obtained puberty. He strongly promoted scientific ethics, which stand diametrically opposed to by most moral codes and ethics that the rest of us follow. Perhaps his belief in his own form of unconventional ethics played a part in his creating the first ransomware program. He was also for eugenics and euthanasia. He didn't believe in anyone having a pet. He pretty much offended almost anyone who lived a conventional life. Suffice to say, his book of recommendations was not a bestseller and did nothing to diminish how strange he was seen by others, even as he was pursuing other careers. Sometimes even an eccentric man can be a gentleman and beloved by others. Just before he died in 2007, Dr. Joe funded the Joseph L. Pop Jr. Butterfly Conservatory in upstate Oneonta, New York. They have their own Facebook page, facebook.com/joseph-l-pop-jr-butterfly-conservatory-119-385-8847-41701. The butterfly operation was still in business at least until the 2020 COVID-19 shutdowns, but the main website domain is now up for sale, and there aren't any TripAdvisor reviews after early January 2020. TripAdvisor.com/attraction_reviews-d-185565-reviews-joseph_l_pop_jr_butterfly_conservatory-oneonta_new_york.html. Some of the early reviews indicated things were looking a bit run down and ragged before the COVID crunch, so maybe it has had its final opening. In his life, Dr. Pop had a few different careers, including evolutionary biologist, author, anthropologist, and butterfly lover. But his likely biggest unwanted claim to fame, something he could not escape the rest of his life, was as the father of ransomware. There are still nearly as many stories on him today as the creator of ransomware in 2021 as there were back in 1990, when his creation was creating digital havoc. His place in history far outlived his own life. More information and stories on Dr. Pop and his PC Cyborg program can be found at the following resources: en.wikipedia.org/wiki/AIDS_%28_Trojan_horse%29. csoonline.com/article/356688/a-history-of-ransomware-the-motives-and-methods-behind-these-evolving-attacks.html. vice.com/en/article/nzpwe7/the-worlds-2021. /first-ransomware-came-on-a-floppy-disk-in-1989. sdxcentral.com/security/definitions/case-study-aids-trojan-ransomware/. thepitchkc.com/dr-pop-the-first-computer-virus-and-the-purpose-human-life-studies-in-crap-gapes-at-popular-evolution/. blog.emsisoft.com/en/34742/history-of-ransomware-a-supervillain-30-years-in-the-making/. village voice.com/2009/04/16/dr-pop-the-first-computer-virus-and-the-purpose-human-life-studies-in-crap-gapes-at-popular-evolution/. gbed2be94-129c-5d5a-a973-2112d-99556a6.html. knowbe4.com/aids-trojan. The PC cyborg ransomware Trojan was a startling wake-up. The lesson learned was that there are people in this world who have no ethical qualms about encrypting your hard drive and asking for a ransom to be paid to unlock it. They were willing to risk going to jail to do it. Surprisingly, after Dr. Pop's Trojan, there wasn't a lot of imitation as antivirus fighters had feared. Perhaps it was because Dr. Pop had not been successful. He didn't get rich. He ended up in jail. Lesson learned. Other criminals learned that it was hard to do digital extortion and get away with it, at least at the time. But in another decade or so, other advances in technology would give them the means to get away with the crime almost every time. Dr. Pop's encryption wasn't very good either. But around the same time period, other types of malware, especially computer viruses, were starting to experiment with better encryption. But encryption was used only to hide and protect the malware program itself from quick antivirus detection and not to encrypt data files and ask for ransom. Slowly, a few slightly better ransomware programs started to appear. Most of them made up their own encryption routines, which is to say, almost always resulted in very bad, easily breakable encryption. These early cryptoviruses, or crypto-trojans as they were known then, rarely required a decryption key to unlock the data. Hobbyist cryptographers often figured how to decrypt the locked files without having to pay the ransom. Good encryption is hard to make. By 2006, a second class of crypto malware started to show up, this time using known and proven cryptographic routines that were not so easy to break. By 2013, ransomware programs using encryption that was really hard to impossible to break were fairly common. As the encryption issue was being fixed, the far bigger problem for criminals was how a ransomware creator could get paid without being caught and sent to jail. Two things happened. First, Bitcoin was invented in 2009. It took a few years, but by 2014, the ransomware programs made the link to Bitcoin, and the whole ransomware industry exploded. Now, criminals could get paid without getting caught. Second, some major countries like Russia became cyber safe havens for ransomware criminals. Today, many ransomware gangs are located in or around Russia and operate with near impunity. Many pay bribes to local and country law enforcement as a part of doing business, and their revenue streams are seen as a net positive in their host countries. As long as they don't encrypt computers in their host or friendly ally countries, they are free to do business with few exceptions. With these two new developments in place, sophisticated ransomware programs started to take out entire businesses, hospitals, police stations, and even entire cities. Today, ransomware is so prolific that entire companies being taken down and ransoms paid in the multi-million dollar range don't even raise an eyebrow. Ransomware attacks are taking down oil pipelines, food production plants, corporate mega conglomerates, closing schools, delaying healthcare, and pretty much exploiting everything they can with near impunity. As I write this, ransomware gangs are likely in their golden years, causing more disruption and making more money than ever before. At this moment, we aren't doing a very good job at stopping it. But we can. That's what this book is about. It's about preventing ransomware from happening in the first place as your number one objective, and minimizing damage if your organization gets hit. Turns out there are many things any organization can do to avoid being hit by ransomware, or to at least significantly minimize the odds. Fighting ransomware is more than having a good, solid backup and up-to-date antivirus program. This book will tell you the best things you can do to prevent a ransomware attack from happening in the first place, better than any other source you can find. It will tell you the details of what you need to do before you are possibly hit by ransomware, and what to do step by step if you are exploited. You don't have to be a victim. You can fight back. Anyone can be a victim of ransomware. Ransomware is difficult to defeat currently. The aim of this book is not to say that you can 100% defeat ransomware. You can't. No one can make that claim. Cybersecurity defense is about risk minimization, not elimination. My goal is to help you minimize the risk as much as possible. If you follow the ideas and steps in this book, you will minimize your risk of a successful ransomware exploit as best you can, given the current state of what we can do until we get new defenses that work better for us all, covered in Chapter 2, Preventing Ransomware. Fight the good fight. Who this book is for? This book is primarily aimed at anyone who is in charge of managing their organization's computer security, from the frontline defender to the top computer security executive. It is for anyone who is considering reviewing, buying, or implementing computer security defenses for the first or the tenth time. What it will take to prevent and mitigate ransomware is what it'll take to prevent and mitigate all malicious hackers and malware. The lessons taught in this book, if followed, will significantly reduce risk of all malicious hackers and malware attacks. Even if one day ransomware goes away, the lessons learned here will readily apply to the next big attack. Ransomware is not your real problem. It's an outcome of your real problem. What is covered in this book? Ransomware Protection Playbook contains 12 chapters separated into two distinct parts. Part 1, Introduction. Part 1 summarizes what ransomware does, how sophisticated it is, and how to prevent it from exploiting your organization and devices. Many people don't understand how mature ransomware is, and even more don't concentrate enough on stopping it before it attacks. Chapter 1. Introduction to Ransomware. Chapter 1 covers ransomware, starting with a little bit of history of the significant milestones, and then discusses the very sophisticated and mature versions used today. The ransomware industry is run much more like a multi-level marketing firm / ecosystem than anything else. Chapter 1 will cover the common pieces and parts. As an encompassing introduction, it is also the longest chapter in the book. Chapter 2. Preventing ransomware. Preventing ransomware is something that isn't talked about enough. The most recommended prevention control, a good backup, is not prevention at all. Chapter 2 will talk about the things every person and organization should be doing to prevent ransomware to the best of their ability. And in the process of discussing how to defeat ransomware, it will discuss how to best defeat all malicious hackers and malware. Chapter 3. Cybersecurity Insurance. The decision to purchase cyber insurance is a big dilemma for organizations facing the threat of ransomware. Cyber insurance is complex. Chapter 3 gives listeners a basic understanding of cyber insurance, including the things that should be avoided when considering a policy. It ends with a frank discussion of the massive changes happening in the cybersecurity industry right now and where it's headed. Chapter 4. Legal Considerations. Chapter 4 covers the legal considerations involved with dealing with a successful ransomware attack, not only in the decision of whether to pay or not pay the ransom, although that is a big part of this chapter, but also how to use legal help to your benefit during an attack. Chapter 4 will contain tips and recommendations that every organization should utilize in their planning and responses to ransomware. Part 2. Detection and Recovery. Part 2 will help you plan for and respond to a successful ransomware attack. Chapter 5. Ransomware Response Plan. Every organization should have a detailed ransomware response plan created and practiced ahead of an actual ransomware event. Chapter 5 will cover what your ransomware response plan should contain. Chapter 6. Detecting Ransomware. If you can't stop a cybersecurity exploit from happening, the next best thing is early warning and detection. Chapter 6 covers the best ways to detect ransomware and gives you the best chance to stop it before it begins to do real damage. Chapter 7. Minimizing Damage. Chapter 7 assumes ransomware has been able to successfully compromise an environment and has encrypted files and exfiltrated data. How do you minimize the spread of ransomware and its damage during the first hours of the first day? Chapter 7 tells you how. Chapter 8. Early Responses. After the initial damage has been prevented from spreading further, now comes the initial cleanup, better assessment, and additional responses beyond just preventing further spread. Chapter 8 is what you need to be doing after the first day or two. How well you perform this part of the response often determines how long it'll take to fully recover. Chapter 9. Environment Recovery. Chapter 9 covers what you need to be doing after the first few days. You've stopped the spread, minimized the damage, and started to get some initial systems back up and working. Chapter 9 is what you need to be doing after the initial worst is over. It covers the longer-term items, the ones that often take days to weeks or even months to recover or rebuild. Chapter 10. Next Steps. So despite your best prevention efforts, you were successfully compromised by ransomware. Chapter 10 covers what lessons you need to learn and what mitigations you need to implement to prevent it from happening again. Many ransomware victims skip this step and often get hit again, and usually the additional times are worse. Learn what you need to learn and do to become more resilient against ransomware. Chapter 11. What Not to Do. Knowing what not to do is as important as what to do in an emergency. Many ransomware victims have made the situation worse by making critical mistakes early on. Chapter 11 covers the things any organization should avoid doing to not make things even worse than they already are. Chapter 12, Future of Ransomware. Chapter 12 covers the likely future of ransomware, how it will evolve, and what it will ultimately take to defeat it forever. How to contact Wiley or the author. Wiley strives to keep you supplied with the latest tools and information you need for your work. Please check the website at wiley.com/go/ransomware protection playbook, where I'll post additional content and updates that supplement this book should the need arise. If you have any questions, suggestions, or corrections, feel free to email me at roger@bannerets.com. Part 1. Introduction. Chapter 1. Introduction to Ransomware. This chapter is a general introduction to ransomware, starting with the basics and leading to a more mature discussion of all the features and components that make it such a mature and formidable foe today. You will learn that much of the ransomware industry is run much more like a professional corporate industry, rather than like the traditional perception of a few bad guys or gangs hiding out in their basements, drinking jacked-up caffeinated sodas surrounded by empty bags of chips. Instead, you're more likely to find CEOs, payroll departments, professional developers, and business partners. You will come away with a very good understanding of today's ransomware, what and how it does it, and the significant challenges to defeat it. Note to the listeners, this chapter is the longest of the book. How bad is the problem? Many press and security experts seem to compete with each other to use the latest over-the-top superlatives surrounding ransomware. But for once in the computer security world, the statistics and scary reputation are well earned. We have had other very bad long runs of damage-causing malware, such as that from DOS boot viruses, disk formatting computer viruses like Michelangelo, 1992, worms that crashed email and pager systems like the I Love You worm, 2000, rapidly spreading and database crashing worms like SQL Slammer, 2003, the USB key-spreading Conficker, 2008, spam bots, and resource-sucking crypto miners. We've been living with damage-causing malware for a long time. But no previous threat has produced the damage and operational interruption caused by ransomware. It's simply unparalleled in human history, and that is not hyperbole. It might be the tipping point event that forces the Internet to finally be made significantly safer. As bad as ransomware has been and still is, it is still getting worse. The number of attempts against possible victims is growing. The number of successful attacks is growing. The ransoms demanded per exploitation are greater. The percentage of victims paying the ransom is increasing. The overall damage in financial and other terms is growing exponentially. Since the beginning of ransomware, and especially since Bitcoin came around and allowed it to take off, it has been one historic year after historic year for ransomware purveyors and their programs. We are likely living in the golden age of malware, at least from the bad guy's perspective. Here are some of the latest stats at the time of this writing. The FBI says it is investigating about 100 different types of ransomware programs. Reuters.com/technology/FBI-says-it-is-investigating-about-100-types-ransomware-WSJ-2021-06-04/. Ransomware was successful in exploiting 68% of surveyed organizations in 1 year alone. Cyber-edge.com www.content/uploads/2021/04/cyberedge-2021-cdr-report-v1.1-1.pdf. That figure alone is shocking. The same survey listed in the previous bullet point says the average ransom paid in 2020 was $166,475, and 57% of victims paid the ransom. Coveware says the average ransom paid in Q1 2021 was $220,298. coveware.com/blog/ransomware-attack-vectors-shift-as-new-software-vulnerability-exploits-abound. Why is Coveware's figure higher than the previous report? It's likely because Coveware's figure is newer. When I see a lowball ransomware figure, I usually check the date of the statistic, and it's almost always old. And when I mean old, I mean only by a year or two. Either way, ransomware is growing tremendously over time. The highest publicly known paid ransom the author is aware of is $40 million. But there are many in the $5 million to $10 million range. There are likely many privately paid ransoms over $40 million that we are not aware of. This 2019 report, blog.emsisoft.com/en/34822/the-state-of-ransomware-in-the-us-report-and-statistics-2019/, says the average ransomware incident cost $8.1 million and took 287 days to recover from. This vendor states $18 billion was paid globally in ransom, and total costs are in the hundreds of billions of dollars. blog.emsisoft.com/en/3842/the-cost-of-ransomware-in-2021-a-country-by-country-analysis/. In summary, the problem of ransomware is pretty bad and growing over time. Variability of ransomware data. Things are moving so fast in the ransomware world that trying to get up-to-date figures and statistics tends to be like trying to nail the proverbial jello to a wall. Different vendors and surveys in different time periods often say vastly different things. For example, many cybersecurity vendors talk about multi-month average dwell times, where the ransomware gang specifically figured out the exact maximum ransom they could ask for, while others will tell you that most ransomware attacks happen right after the break-in or within hours of the initial successful exploitation, and all the victims are asked the same fixed fee. Who is right? Likely everyone. There are at least 100 different ransomware programs coded by all sorts of criminals of varying skill levels and experiences, successfully attacking tens to hundreds of thousands of organizations and people a year. Different ransomware groups also target different industries, sectors, and regions. The figures and stats are bound to vary widely. Even the exact same answer can have a different number from the same vendor. For example, the Coveware Q1 2021 report figure listed before states that the average ransom paid was $220,298. But in the same report, it also says the median ransom payment was $78,398. The two figures don't even seem close. This seemingly statistical anomaly means that a few victims on the upper end are paying far more than the rest of the victims, which brings up the overall average for everyone. It turns out having to pay a few $5 million and $10 million ransoms will skew results. So if you're trying to figure out how much a ransom payment might cost your company, which figure do you use in your estimation calculation? It varies based on your perspective. The most conservative answer is if you want to be safe and set aside for the worst-case scenario, then use the highest reasonable estimate. But who knows? If your organization gets hit by ransomware, the criminals might ask for an unreasonable figure. Certainly none of the organizations hit by the multi-million-dollar ransoms would agree with the reasonableness of the request. How much you might have to pay really comes down to what type of ransomware program you got hit with, how bad things got before damage control started to happen, and how recovery goes. And no one knows those answers until they are in the thick of things. It's like going into surgery with a bad pain in your lower left quadrant and asking the doctor what the cost of the operation will be before they've put you to sleep. No one knows. With that said, no matter what figures you grab and whether they are using averages, medians, or last year's figures, the damage caused by ransomware is bad and getting worse. The total involved costs can easily be millions for multi-million dollar organizations and tens to hundreds of millions for multi-billion dollar organizations. Smaller amounts of ransom can even be devastating to smaller organizations. True costs of ransomware. Many defenders, when trying to argue for the need to defend against ransomware, must come up with the potential damages that might occur from a ransomware event. The damages incurred by one organization vary drastically from another, according to size of the organization, revenue stream, preparation, value of the involved data, how bad the incident is, and ability to respond to a particular ransomware attack. There are a lot of variables at play. Get hit with a very simple ransomware program that was really meant to hit a consumer at home, and the cost could be less than $1,000 to clean up a single exploited computer. Get hit by another ransomware variant, and it could mean the whole network is down for weeks to months. Still, many defenders are asked to come up with estimated costs to help with cybersecurity risk management decisions around ransomware, such as whether to buy cybersecurity insurance, upgrade that old backup system, or what to invest in next to try to prevent a ransomware attack from being successful in their organization. Unfortunately, as covered earlier, the risk from ransomware and costs abound and vary greatly. One of the biggest disagreements you will see between vendors and reports is the cost of ransomware or something like that. For example, one vendor like Cybersecurity Ventures will publish a huge figure like ransomware costing $20 billion in 2021 and to grow to $256 billion in damages by 2031. cybersecurityventures.com/global-ransomware-damage-costs-predicted-2-reach-250-billion-USD-BY-2031/. And another, you'll have someone saying the cost is only in the low millions of dollars. For example, the FBI's very respected 2020 Internet Crime Report, ic3.gov/media/pdf/annual-report/2020_ic3-report.pdf, stated, in 2020, the IC3 received 2,474 complaints identified as ransomware with adjusted losses of over $29.1 million. So, one vendor is saying $20 billion in 2021, while another agency is saying just $29.1 million in 2020. I doubt ransomware damage doubled more than 687 times higher in 1 year alone. The key to reconciling these huge discrepancies and deciding which number is more accurate is in realizing they are often reporting drastically different things. In the FBI's instance, they are reporting only on ransomware events reported to them. At the most, it would only include U.S. victims, and even then it has to be a very small percentage of ransomware victims. The larger figures in the billions always include global considerations. Still, the FBI's numbers seem low. If you divide the quoted losses, $29.1 million, by the number of victims, 2,474, you only get an average damage loss of $11,762. I'm not sure what the FBI's adjust losses figures include, but that seems very low, even if it only included ransom. Most of the other ransomware reports are showing numbers well over $50,000 to over $200,000 for the ransom alone. Perhaps a big part of the difference is that adjusted losses likely only include accounting realized losses after an insurance claim clicked in. This 2020 study, sophos.com/en-us/gated-assets/white-papers/sophos-the-state-of-ransomware-2020-wp.pdf, stated that 64% of ransomware victims had cybersecurity insurance that covered ransomware. So nearly two-thirds of ransomware hit victims likely had only a much smaller deductible to pay, and not the whole ransom amount, unless the ransom and damages went over the ceiling of their coverage. Many vendors reporting ransomware statistics report on both the ransom paid and the money spent to get the victim back up and running. Many ransomware events can include other indirect costs that many people don't think about that are often not listed in most reports. If you are trying to do a risk assessment calculation for either mitigating ransomware, calculating if you can afford a cybersecurity insurance premium, or having to calculate all the real costs from a ransomware event, consider these related costs. Whether or not a ransomware event has occurred, cost of ransomware mitigations to prevent an attack in the first place, increase in backup costs and labor to prepare to recover from a ransomware event, cybersecurity insurance premiums, if any. If a ransomware event has occurred, costs of ransom paid, if any, recovery expenses, business interruption losses by the intended victim and downstream impacts, law enforcement and investigation costs, personnel changes, adds/deletes/changes, if any, productivity slowdowns due to new procedures and protections, if any, reputational harm, additional defense preparations to mitigate the next attack, cyber insurance deductible/retention. When you consider all the costs associated with recovering from a ransomware attack, you can see that they can be a lot over and above and beyond just paying the ransom and recovery damages. This is to say that preventing ransomware from occurring in the first place is almost always the cheaper option. Types of ransomware. There is no singular type of ransomware, although the majority of it does have common features that most of us have come to associate with the ransomware descriptor, including the following. It is a malicious software program, that is, malware. It sneaks or is secretly placed onto a victim's computers or devices. It has the ability to encrypt files. It asks for a ransom to provide the decryption keys. Since the very first ransomware program, the PC Cyborg Trojan from 1989, covered in this book's introduction, most traditional ransomware has followed this basic pattern for the first two decades of their existence. But ransomware has changed over time. There are many different types of ransomware, and as this book is being written, significant evolutionary changes are continuing to happen. By understanding the different types, you can more fully appreciate that if you are involved with a ransomware attack, what the ransomware does isn't monolithic, and you can be more prepared for any differences. Here are the different types and traits of various ransomware programs. Fake ransomware. immediate action versus delayed, automatic or human-directed, one device or multiple device impact, Trojan versus worm, file encrypting versus boot infection, good versus bad encryption, infection versus more payloads, ransomware as a service. Fake ransomware. Not all malware that claims to be ransomware is really encrypting files and taking ultimate control over someone's computer. There are many far less sophisticated malware programs and simple JavaScript applets that claim to be ransomware but are simply fake. They are not encrypting anything. They are generally known as scareware. They usually take over a person's current internet browsing session in such a way that the involved victim may believe they have lost control of their computer or phone and must pay the ransom to get back control. The fake ransomware demands are often communicated along with the claim that the victim was recorded doing something embarrassing, for example, watching porn, etc., or doing something illegal, for example, watching child porn, not paying their lawful taxes, etc. Figure 1.1 shows such a fake ransomware warning, claiming to involve the U.S. Department of Justice and Federal Bureau of Investigations, FBI. Fake ransomware warnings are popular on mobile media devices as well. You might wonder who could possibly believe this warning, especially with the suggested payment methods. But some percentage of people have paid the ransom demanded by fake ransomware programs for decades. There have even been multiple suicides and even at least one murder-suicide. hotforsecurity.bit.defender.com/blog/romanian-man-commits-suicide-and-kills-his-4-year-old-after-falling-4-police-ransomware-8168.html. By victims believing the fake ransomware notices and feeling ashamed of their purported actions. It's very sad. In most cases of fake ransomware, all the victim has to do is find out a way to remove the fake ransomware program from their computer. It is the easiest type to remove in that generally it simply requires restarting the involved browser program, although that can take some effort as the ransomware program takes control of the browser. Some fake ransomware victims can easily close their impacted browser, while others have to somehow forcibly close the program. On Microsoft Windows, that may involve hitting Control-Alt-Delete, starting Task Manager, and then killing the involved processes. If the browser cannot be closed or restarted, it may only take a reboot if the fake ransomware program has not modified any local computer files. In my anecdotal experience, most fake ransomware programs can be eradicated by closing the browser or rebooting the involved device. Although, if your restarted browser automatically opens your last page, it can be an additional pain to stop the automatic reloading. If the fake ransomware program was able to modify local device files and hence will automatically reappear and have control after a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.